Good afternoon and welcome to Wise Debate 2.6. New entrants, diversifying providers. New players from high-tech manufacturers to IT startups and social entrepreneurs are attempting to find and fill gaps in educational provision. However, some people question their legitimacy as education providers. How best to monitor and control these offerings so that they contribute to attaining national and international goals for access and quality of learning? These are just some of the questions that we hope to explore. So with that, I think a basic set of housekeeping underway, I'd like to introduce you to our four, I don't know if they're panelists, I don't know if they're debaters, we'll see if they're actually in opposition or debating each other this afternoon. Discussants, I guess we can say. I will start here closest to me, Her Excellency, Naledi Pandor, who is the Minister of Home Affairs in the Republic of South Africa. Next to her is Dr. Matthew Kam, who is the Senior Technology Strategist for Education at the American Institutes for Research. To Matt's left is Ms. Tamara Minnick-Skokolo, who is the President for EMEA, that's Europe, Middle East, and Africa region, and the interim CEO of Pearson International. And last but certainly not least, at the end of the stage is Dr. Subraya Belayur Manjapa. He's the Vice President and Dean of the Global Education Center for Infosys Technologies Limited of India. And I'll start with Naledi Pandor. Madam Minister, this topic of new entrants in the education sector, how is it relevant to you in South Africa? Are you seeing new entrants into education? And if so, why do you think that's happening? And how do you and how do your countrymen and women feel about it?
Well, good afternoon and thank you. I think the topic certainly is relevant for South Africa. The new entrants take many diverse forms. And while we have begun responding to some of what might be called new entrants, I would think in particular of those in need of adult basic education, which wasn't a large area of provision in South Africa before the advent of democracy. So while we've begun responding to such new entrants, I think we've been inadequate in terms of addressing the particular needs of adult women who are at home and who might require literacy programs or skills development initiatives in technical or other skills. I also think that we haven't responded sufficiently according to the recent Census 2011 report in South Africa to persons who have only primary schooling or no schooling and are young adults or adults. So in the ages 24 to 40, it's emerged that there are significant numbers of potential new entrants for whom we actually don't have an institutional framework that can absorb them and offer them opportunity. So this is a gap that we are looking to addressing.
Interesting. And so, Matt Kam, are there other gaps you see in other education systems that are perhaps being filled by various new entrants into the education space?
Okay, well, I guess I'll first start by mentioning that I'm also a new entrant in the sense that I'm a computer scientist by training, working in international education and international development. So that itself is a very unusual combination. So when we talk about new entrants, well, at least in the line of my own work and my own research, so there's definitely one line of new entrants coming in, which is technology companies trying to actually provide for a higher quality of education through technology product offerings. There's also another line of new entrants, social entrepreneurs. And again, that is a label that's really, really broad, lots of diversity in it. So I would just mention that one type of social entrepreneurs that I've seen and done research with would be this phenomenon around low-cost private schools that we are starting to see in various developing countries. It was briefly mentioned earlier today also in previous sessions. So one of the things that I've just done and wrapped up was a one-year-long pilot study using low-cost mobile phone technology in which we actually developed so-called reading literacy software for English literacy. And we actually had this software developed especially for these low-end feature phones. And we did this pilot with four different low-cost private schools in India. So that's something that is currently under review. I'm happy to share it with anybody who's interested. Just email me for that. So that's one entrance that came in because you know, there's this general perception that government schools are not really delivering accountability in terms of education. Teachers are not showing up. So, and if teachers don't show up, well, some of these social entrepreneurs basically take things into their own hands. They say, well, if parents are willing to pay for this education, well, why don't we set up our own schools? You know, and of course, when they run their own private schools that cater to kids in households that earn just a few dollars a day, well, they have to make sure that teachers actually show up. Otherwise, parents are not going to send their kids to schools. They're not going to pay fees.
Thanks, Matt. And hopefully we'll have an opportunity to explore some of the findings from your research, which I believe is just about to be published. Tamara, Matt mentioned technology providers. And while Pearson is certainly an old player, it is also a new entrant in various ways in various markets around the world. And I've heard Pearson referred to as an educational publisher, as an assessment company, and as a technology company. How do you see this, and how is Pearson related to this phenomenon of new entrants providing educational service delivery of various sorts around the world?
Thanks, Mike. I was smiling when Matt said he's a new entrant because I'm a new entrant as well. After 28 years in consumer products and 2 years leading a high-tech startup, I bring a different perspective into the education space and into Pearson, so I'm also a new entrant. To your point, where you've got 200 years in publishing of textbooks, 100 years in writing exams, but we also are into technology and we find ourselves needing to disrupt ourselves as disruptors are starting to accelerate the disruption in both those fields. But if I think of as a new entrant into this category, sort of four different areas I bring from that perspective where there's either disruption happening or it needs to happen, I would say one is, as a commercial employer before, that growing gap in skills needed versus skills available is growing in places like the CTI and MGI colleges, which were a new entrant in South Africa, which saw a need for IT professional technical skills in the market, filled it, broadened it out to other professional development, now has 12 campuses, over 10,000 students. And the good news is over 75% of the graduates within 1 year have a job in their field of choice. Another great example of that is around Teach for America and Teach First, which are about attracting top quality talent into the back into the teaching industry, something I know that has been discussed in many platforms here at WISE. Another area or different perspective is about putting the consumer or the learner at the heart of everything we do. And that is really focusing on learner outcomes in everything we do, the user experience as we bring technology, how are we engaging students in the process, and the use of data to ever improve what we do. And then the area of open innovation. We're looking more and more that innovation doesn't have to happen within our four walls. How do we work together to connect and develop to get greater, bigger, better innovation happening? And whether it's in the old guys like us or new entrants working together, how do we collaborate in that space for open innovation? And the last area, again, from my background is we looked hard at how we could get best-in-class ideas scaled around the world fast. And I think now more than ever, we need to scale best-in-class education ideas to impact more learners around the world faster. And I think the disruption that's needed there and has been talked here is collaboration. It's collaboration across government, across NGOs, and across the private sector. And how do we use health as an example here, where they really took all three of those, collaborated hard against a very measurable specific goals around attacking malaria, AIDS, TB, and made a dramatic impact. If we could disrupt ourselves to get greater collaboration in the education space against the next set of Millennium Development Goals, I think we could together make an enormous difference in education.
Thank you. Dr. Subraya, you decidedly work for a technology company, Infosys. What is your relationship to this topic? Does Infosys provide education services? Why are you interested, and why are you up on the stage here with us today?
It's really interesting. See, we are not providing the education service, but we are the consumer of education services. It reminds me of a story that, you know, but just a couple of months back, a new entrant came to me. And then he requested me, okay, we will provide the education service. What is that? We will provide you huge content. And we have to train about more than 20,000 people every year. Okay, everything we'll provide to you. They can access, you know, they can learn at any time. But immediately I asked, so we have collaboration with more than 500 universities where we provide all contents, whatever we have prepared from ourselves. They said, okay, we can provide, what is that? So we can provide much more content than that. Hey, look at that. See, the learner, he wants a small swimming pool rather than a big ocean that what you're providing. So the point is, you know, so if you're looking at the gap, first thing is the accessibility. The accessibility is a major problem in the remote area, and affordability. Affordability is another area. Particularly in India, we have remote places where people are not in a position to access as well as afford it also. And at the same time, today there's a lack of quality teachers. That's why there are new entrants, provides a lot of stuff related to the education space. Not only that, you know, today learners are expecting the global connect. You know, the technology is so fast, that is why they wanted to get in touch with everyone, because since it's a global village. So from this perspective, if you are looking at it, how the education providers, probably we can categorize it. So typically the institutional providers, the universities, you know, conventional universities, age-old universities, they're the education providers. Not only that, the nation, federal government, state government, and, you know, NGOs, these are the people they're providing education space. And the third is that category is the corporate, private players. By looking at all the three, so if you're looking at how they're providing the educations today by leveraging the technology, all of them are leveraging the technology. Institution, so look at the standard university, old university, Stanford, CMU, they're all, you know, leveraging the technology and providing educations to everyone. You know, at the same time, the government organizations, if you are looking at it, they are also leveraging the technology. In India, we have a dedicated channel for high school students, a dedicated channel for various learners. So they are also leveraging the technology. But on the other side, the private players, so they say that they are also, you know, leveraging the technology, but in a different way. Probably today, the social media is coming up, mobile computing is coming up. So they're all leveraging the technology. See, from this perspective, if you categorize it, you know, there are three major players. One is the conventional, who have proven capability in providing the education. But at the same time, there are private players who are leveraging the technology and providing the education space. This is my perspective.
And so there's a strong technology theme emerging here, and there are a number of ways this discussion can go, I think. Madam Minister, we've heard about the traditional providers, the state, civil society, and the private sector. How do you see these different groups? Are there specific roles for these groups in South Africa in providing education? How do you see these different groups working together or perhaps working at loggerheads?
Well, I think the private sector certainly has become a growing player in the space in South Africa. But our experience in the early phase of their entry was that not all of them are honest players, that essentially they're looking for markets. And many were bringing programs that were of very poor quality. And the country didn't have an adequate quality assurance system, both to protect the consumer as well as to ensure that what is provided is adequate in terms of the standard, the curriculum standards that were set. So we had to formulate a framework for private providers and legislation that would both protect them and protect those who would utilize their services. We had a phenomenon of what we called fly-by-night providers who would appear one night, get a whole lot of persons registering for program, and the next day they're gone. So they fly by night and disappear. So we had to put measures in place to ensure that those who are registered as providers are actually genuine providers of education programs. And it is an important area that we must address. We're now confronting it with many foreign institutions coming to offer higher education programs on the African continent. We've been fortunate in South Africa in that we went through that process of developing the legislative framework and therefore were able to adequately deal with new entrants into the higher education space. But there are many countries on the continent that have had terrible experiences and have had to, at a fairly late stage, begin to respond when people had lost a great deal of money as well as opportunity. So certainly the private sector is, I believe, an important contributor. I also think new entrants are new users of the services, but also new entrants are those who devise new programs, such as the technology, the young software engineers that are being spoken of here. Recently, we had a huge challenge in South Africa in the failure of an education department to deliver textbooks to schools in a particular province. And young people in one of our universities created a website on which they uploaded all the common textbooks for the subjects offered in that province and created a program they call Siavula, we are opening up, for young people to access for free any of the textbooks that they would need. So it was young university students responding to an immediate problem and thus becoming themselves new providers for new entrants. So you can have the responses taking many different innovative shapes.
So that's fascinating, and a fascinating potential group of new entrants. And so I can't resist when I hear the students entering the education space in this way and loading textbooks to the internet for free access to go to our colleague from Pearson here and ask, so what sort of advice or what sort of advice would you have for governments as they think about how to ensure quality and how to have a framework for understanding and whether it's regulating and working with private providers from the private sector's perspective? What would you like to see and what advice might you have for government?
Yeah, I mean, I think, again, this is a great area of collaboration, and clearly the government needs to own the regulation and oversight of the quality. But it's quite important that we work together to define what are those measures of success, what do learner outcome improvements really look like, and we at Pearson are working hard to, with Sir Michael Barber as our head, our chief education officer, to really look at how do we measure and look at every single product and service we offer and tie it back to learner outcomes. And if it's not good enough, how are we putting improvement plans in place, et cetera, so that we have metrics that prove before we get it on the marketplace that it is really improving learner outcomes. I saw a similar situation in Nigeria when I was recently there. Therefore, I mean, it really is a chronic issue where there's probably 2,000 registered private K-12 schools in Lagos, and there's probably 12,000 operating. And with an emerging middle class, not as a middle class in developed markets as we might think of it, but people who are starting to have a bit of discretionary income, they so much want to spend their next dollar on education to improve the lives of their children, and we need to make sure it's well spent. So working with government to help define those standards, live within them, oversee them is quite important.
Thanks. And Matt, it looked like you wanted to jump in with a comment there.
Yeah, that's right. So the thing about trying to do learning assessments and all that, I think that's great. So I thought I would just add one point, which is that, so before I joined the American Institutes for Research, I used to be a professor at Carnegie Mellon University. So I did research on education. And so it's very important, I think, to make sure that whatever learning assessments that get done is actually rigorous from a research standpoint, so that we could also see, you know, well, against a control group, well, what exactly was the improvement that this this intervention or this new service that a new entrant is providing actually delivers. Yeah, and so I mentioned that also because, in my experience, I think talking to technology companies and people who wants to do this coming from the private sector to address gaps in the education system, I noticed that there is a bit of this disconnect or maybe a difference in the value system and priorities. In the sense that I think commercial providers tend to be great at thinking about scalability and sustainability, and those are issues that are very important to them, and it's part of their expertise, and that's great. But at the same time, I in this whole equation, it seems that on the other side of it, there's also this concern about education quality in the sense that, the voice of the educator sometimes gets drowned out when we talk about scalability, sustainability. And what I mean by the voice of the educator getting drowned out is that, I was an educator myself, so when I teach students, one of the things that I realized was that depending on who the students are, okay, so I'm not dealing with students in, say, developing countries. I had pretty good students. So I didn't have to deal with all those basic cognitive skills or basic knowledge, you know, that on Andreas Schleicher's presentation yesterday was pointing out, that these are fairly basic and there are more of the higher level stuff that we as educators can deal with. So I did some reflection last night about that, and I thought, yeah, a lot of the stuff that I teach, well, it's pretty commoditized, but there are some stuff that I do as an educator that you probably find it hard to scale. So that would be things like the kinds of mentoring that I provide students with, helping them to see things with a new outlook in life, encouraging them, you know, to challenge themselves, to be better than what they think they can be. So that's the kind of stuff that we see, that tension between skill versus trying to just teach individual students really well. Because at the end of the day, as a good educator, we sometimes measure our success in terms of the lives that we have impacted. And every single student is a unique person, a unique story. And we don't really want to count impact in terms of numbers sometimes.
Thank you, Dr. Subraya.
Yeah, I would like to add a couple of points here. I agree with the Honorable Minister that is, there must be a quality standard at the global level. Look at the internet today, World Wide Web. That's a standard body who controls and then who provides the direction. But in the education body, at the global level, we don't have quality standards. Let me give an example. Let us look at the content. So contents, what is that we expect the content? You know, a professor, he sits in a remote place, if he creates the content for the globe, I think it is really challenging, it's really difficult. See, what we expect is a global content, global standard, content with global standard, but customizable to the local needs. See, if I take an example to explain a concept, so probably somewhere sitting at Fremont, USA, at the same time, a learner probably in remote South African countries, it's very difficult to comprehend that. But at the same time, the concept is required at the global standard. But is there any way that we can customizable to the local needs? So that is the kind of standard probably we may have to define it. For that, is there any body? Yes, true, we need a body for that. Not only that, at the same time, look at the assessment. Assessment, we don't have a standard mechanism for assessment. There is no standard body. So probably in USA, the Abbott accreditation body is there. Every country has its own accreditation body. But at the global level, is there any standard bodies available? No. So that is a big challenge. But at the same time, if you're looking at the assessment and content together, ultimately the learner, what he wants it, he is looking at, one is define the content, which is critical in nature, but at the same time, what is the relevance? A content should be relevant to my development. And if it is critical, identify those critical content. But at the same time, which are the contents, which are the concepts that I have to retain a longer time? That is the retention factor. So the criticality, the relevance, and the retention factor. So the three attributes, if you define it to define a content, the means is, you know, we need to have a standard body. That's the quality standards we have to define. If you are looking at a global level, you know, looking at the education space.
So that's interesting. And this idea of having global standards. So in some places I know countries work with private providers in a way to, in a way, import global standards or expose themselves to global standards. I know Pearson works pretty much everywhere. Is this a role for Pearson? Is this a role for private providers of educational service? How do you see this issue of standards and content and then the localization of that content?
Yeah, I think if we strip it down to 21st century skills around literacy, numeracy, the real core skills that we're going to need to give students into the 21st century, I think we can work on spines of content that are relevant everywhere. I think the localization of that content is still important to make it relevant and teach it and make it come alive for the students in each country. But I think working with ministries and governments on the curriculum, what makes good spines of content. I actually, Mike, if I could just divert for 1 second, I wanted to build on Matt's idea of scaling teachers just for 1 second, and then I'll let somebody else take over on the previous subject. Around teaching, I think there is such a gap today globally in the quality of teaching that we've identified that while you're right, individual teachers make the real difference and have certain ways of having that come to life. But if we don't start attracting back in and figuring out in a scaled way different ways to do that, like Teach for America, et cetera, and if we don't find what are the kinds of skills we need teachers to have and try to scale that around the world, or if you flip the whole model on the head and say, if I have a great teacher, how can that teacher impact more people like MOOCs? Right? You know, MOOCs is about taking great Stanford professors in Udacity and using that professor in a scaled way to impact more learners' outcomes, et cetera. So I think you're right, we can't scale a person in. People make a difference in how they teach and how they take good to great. But if we don't start thinking of scaled ways to both attract, retain, and develop great teachers, we can throw all the technology we want at it in the world. Technology is a great enabler for a teacher. Teachers still make a very critical difference in taking good to great.
Now, I was going to say that one interesting set of examples of scalability are the open university systems. I think several of them actually have used technology to excellent effect in reaching hundreds of thousands of students of various ages, backgrounds, and ensuring that they get equivalent quality of material. So I think your University of South Africa, Open University in the UK, and several other institutions have a reach and material development that actually makes our subject very, very interesting when we probe what they're doing. And what I have found fascinating is the manner in which technology has allowed such universities to reach persons who often wouldn't be reached by higher education, women in rural areas, farm workers on farm communities who have senior school certificates but have not been able to study for a degree. Suddenly, an open university establishes a center close to where they live, and they have access to the best technology, the best lecturer in subjects they wish to pursue, and they actually then are able to acquire a graduate qualification. So I think what some of the open and distance institutions are doing is a really significant impact in terms of diversifying provision, but also allowing those who might be excluded and ignored an opportunity to enter
the education space.
So I think this example of open universities and massively open online courses are two examples that are really enabled by technology in ways that without ICTs, it would be very difficult to imagine these types of services even occurring. Dr. Subraya, do you see that this particular area, reaching out with technology to learners and to the people who help learners in remote areas, is a particular area of opportunity for new entrants or non-traditional providers?
Yes and no. It depends upon accessibility and affordability. Let us come to the accessibility. In the remote area, what is the need for the accessibility? See, the infrastructure. So in certain countries, in certain areas, infrastructure, we don't have it. See, probably, you know, there's a huge power cut, varies from, you know, 5 hours to 8 hours. And then if the technology is, you know, has to be used, it's very, very difficult. But on the other hand, yes, the contents are available anytime, they can learn anywhere. The question is it, you know, the teacher can be replaceable? Yes and no. So the smart guy is probably without a teacher, he can definitely learn. But the other side, you know, an average person, maybe it's very difficult. So to my mind, a teacher means, you know, he's not just teaching. He's a guide, he's a philosopher, he's a mentor. Probably in general, he's a transformational agent. So that is totally missing when you use the technology. So probably, you know, a teacher touch is always missing when you use the technology. I'll give you another example, simple example. Let us say, if a kid wants to enjoy with his parents, let's say a father or a mother, and do you mean to say that is he can enjoy through the technology? Okay, so I can simulate the father and then I can touch on the screen. Is it possible to enjoy? There is no way. That human touch means here in the education space, the teacher touch is totally missing when it comes to the technology. But at the same time, the point to the answer that is accessibility, yes. Nowadays, at least 60 to 70%, you know, people they can access. Another major problem, challenge is, you know, societal challenge. In a sense, today, in remote areas, people are not in a position to reach the school because of various external interventions. Not only that, in some areas, there's a societal stigma. Because of that, they can't go to school and then learn. But on the other hand, if the technology is available, yes, by sitting in their home, they can learn at least. I don't know at what level they can learn, but at least a platform is available. By using this platform, they can learn. So my answer is yes and no.
So, and Matt, did you want to jump in? I wasn't sure if it was on the human touch element or on what part, but please.
Okay, well, I'm always a guy who screams to my fellow computer scientists that we need to bring more of the human touch into technology design. But by extension, I think I view content as part of the technology also. So I thought I'll just try to stir up the complexity around accessibility, because accessibility is not just infrastructure and all those stuff. It also there's also an aspect to accessibility in terms of how equipped the learner actually is in order to make sense of the content. So you can have great content that MOOCs, you know, while a superstar professor at Stanford, say, could be teaching a class, and you use MOOCs to make that accessible to students all over the world. So in my experience, all that is great for students coming from middle-income backgrounds. The challenge really is that the same content wouldn't be quite in the right shape that kids coming from less privileged backgrounds would actually be equipped to assess meaningfully. So what I mean by that is that, you know, we have done this project in the past where we looked at a government syllabus in India, in the state of Andhra Pradesh, for English literacy, you know, and they specified a list of things that fifth graders should learn. So that's this level of stuff. But when we go down to interact with fifth grade students, we find that they are actually maybe comparable to a second grader in terms of their competency. So there's this mismatch. And when we designed the technology, we actually had to do a lot of so-called scaffolding and remedial content. So basically putting in that gap material so that we could also target the prerequisite knowledge that students who are entering fifth grade in the underprivileged areas in India could actually take to learn so that they'll be equipped to actually learn the official curriculum for fifth graders that the government was specifying. So there's so much of that kind of localization that needed to be done in terms of their prior knowledge. And we know from the science of how humans learn that, you know, that humans don't come into learning situations as blank slates, but there's a lot of prior knowledge and beliefs that they bring in with them. And we need to account for all that when we do instructional design or when we design lesson plans or whatever. Another thing about localization that we found also was that, you know, these days, I mean, there's this big fashion statement about doing educational games, okay? And when we first went into India trying to do educational games, because, yeah, it's one way to make the learning process fun. But when we first started doing educational games, the kids in the villages were not making sense of the games at all, okay? Because we came in there with a different set of exposure and mindset about what video games were. Didn't match the kinds of physical playground games that children in villages grew up playing. Okay, so we eventually had to actually take a step back, learn from them what were the games that they enjoyed playing every day, which was a lot of running and physical motion, very different from the video games that we first designed, right? I mean, Western video games had a lot of Western cultural connotations in them, like, okay, you have to collect all the gold coins. And this goal just wasn't making sense to the village kid. Why do I have to collect all the gold coins to win? So eventually we studied the kinds of village games that they played, studied how those characteristics in village games were different from contemporary Western video games that we're all familiar with, and used all this as guidelines to actually do culturally relevant game designs for them. So all this is, again, challenges that you wouldn't face if you're trying to do educational technology for middle-income students from those backgrounds. But for students coming from less privileged backgrounds, there's really a lot more work that needs to go in terms of accessibility.
And so perhaps, and I'm getting a couple notes saying, one, we can tweet out some of the results of Matt's research. It's the Millee Project, M-I-L-L-E-E, that could be interesting. But sort of backing up and out a little bit and back to the title of this session on new entrants, we've heard a lot about different players. I'm wondering, Madam Minister, do you have some advice or lessons from the South African experience about how these different groups can work together productively? Are there sets of incentives or perhaps disincentives that need to be removed if these different groups can work together to a common end, which is presumably to develop our children?
Well, I think my observation is that the groups coalesce in organic ways often, and that tends to work best. And where there are organizations that offer specific programs that governments may feel respond to particular objectives that they have, then governments obviously would establish partnerships with those organizations. I've seen this happen primarily with respect to maths and science teaching, where you have some really excellent non-governmental organizations in South Africa that now have a national footprint and have partnerships with government departments and are offering a range of programs using diverse technologies. I think we tend to think of the web as the sole technology, whereas for many of our communities, the radio might be better. So I think we also shouldn't narrow the scope of technology just to web-based offerings, but also accommodate. For us, mobile telephones have been a brilliant intervention, which many, many families, or at least one family member or young people have access to. So we've been able to do some educational programs using mobile technology. I think an aspect we should never neglect is, of course, the issue of new entrants, and particularly those with disabilities, who tend to be ignored by our systems, young persons or learners seeking education who might have hearing disabilities or other forms of disability, and so require us both to develop the technology, to have the resources available so that they are able successfully to participate in the learning enterprise. This is also a new opportunity for providers to respond to this inclusion that many societies are working toward.
So that is one, this opportunity or new opportunity, or perhaps an opportunity that's always been there and only is now being recognized or can be met with new technologies. Do you see, Tamara, other opportunities, other places that offer, that are potentially attractive to various new entrants? Are there opportunities that are perhaps have been not explored, but whether it's through new technologies or new approaches, are viable in 2012 in ways that they weren't perhaps 10 years ago?
I think there's great opportunity for technology in being able to take every child on a personal learning journey and unlocking them in every subject at the pace they can go, and unlocking every child's potential is ultimately the goal. I think in the near term, there are a couple of really interesting areas that enable that. One is, if you really tie up a school's technology ecosystem between the student information systems, the learning management systems, you get to adaptive learning, et cetera, and you can look at the data, back data coming out of that, so we can ever improve and fast cycle learn how to pull that child along, is you can all of a sudden tie in all of the people who are interested in that particular child's outcomes. You can tie in the teacher. They can see where that child is drifting, where they're struggling, and be able to help them faster than they could normally do in an overcrowded big classroom. It allows the parent to look in and see how their child is doing. It allows the student to look in. So that kind of data management to able to pull that child along is quite important. The other thing, and I've always been a big believer that you can't teach without the teacher, and technology is only an enabler. I guess I went to the MIT Media Lab in Boston a few weeks ago, and all I'll say is I still think that the teacher is the single best thing, but where you can't get a teacher, can you accelerate the learning faster? I saw an experiment they've got going out in the countryside of Ethiopia, and my jaw dropped. They had worked with a neuroscientist about how children learn to read. And they took these iPads out into the hinterland country of Ethiopia with apps, but designed and understood from a pedagogical standpoint about how these children could learn to read, write, and speak English. And they had never spoken a word of English. There wasn't a teacher in this countryside. And they just handed out these iPads. They figured it'd take a couple of days for these kids to learn how to turn them on. The first kid learned in 4 minutes and then taught everybody else. They downloaded the back data every day, and they could see children acquiring knowledge at different rates. They also had these iPads taking pictures at certain frequency, and it started out with the child with the iPad, and they were so excited about it, they'd fall asleep with it at night. Then it was several children behind the iPad. Then they had pictures of children teaching other children, you know, Permitra's hole-in-the-wall kind of child-driven learning. These children, within a few months, had made up an alphabet song they had never heard, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, made up an alphabet song. They were reading, writing, and speaking English in elementary form, and there wasn't a teacher to be found anywhere. And I guess what that says is we're starting to get to technology and ability to use back data to improve that. That just think about taking that technology into a teacher-enabled environment. What could we unlock and unleash with that? And how can we help people that don't even have the access to great teachers with technology enable an incredible learning journey?
Thanks. We're about ready to go out to the audience for questions, but Matt, you wanted to jump in.
Yeah, I thought I wanted to jump in because, well, in some sense, when we try to talk about opportunities for technology, sometimes we don't question ourselves hard enough about why we are using technology. And I happen to be a computer scientist who's also a very big skeptic of technology. So I like to always ask that question because I think, in my observation, in any major educational system or any organization or anything that we do, for example, we would probably observe that it is about 20% of those tasks that we do that take up 80% of our time. So that's what you call the bottleneck. Those 20% constitutes the bottleneck. So I usually use the metaphor of the bottleneck to try to explain to both my colleagues and to other folks that if we want to use technology, I think the real question is, can we actually identify what are those bottlenecks in existing education systems that are causing us a lot of obstacles that's keeping us from actually realizing that vision of a much better educational future that we want to realize, and then see which of these bottlenecks are amenable to technological interventions so that we can actually specifically and strategically target them and use technology to address them. So let me just give one example of what a bottleneck might look like. So for example, sometimes we talk about out-of-school youths, and we know that youth sometimes don't have time to go on to schools to be getting further vocational training, for example. And the bottleneck in that situation is that they just don't have time to be going to vocational training because they might have to be making money to feed themselves and all that. So in that situation, can we think about technology to allow and facilitate a lot of learning at convenient hours, you know, mobile learning, for example, so that there would be learning that's taking place that otherwise wouldn't take place. So that's one possibility in which we can think very strategically. And I'm saying that because when we think about technology, it is expensive. I mean, I'm an engineer who builds technologies, and I know how expensive it is. So we need to also ask ourselves really hard, where is the returns on investment?
Excellent. And certainly these bottlenecks, I think, are potential opportunities, and potential opportunities for whether new entrants or new constellations of actors. Dr. Subraya, would you like to comment, and then we'll go out to the floor?
Just I would like to comment on technology and the new entrants once again. You know, the technology, I feel that it is a supportive agent. Today morning, I was looking at the survey conducted by WISE about various questions. Is it possible to replace, the entire education system by the technology? It is not possible. Because in one of the questions, they said, you know, the physical education is a must. More than 80% of the people opted for, you know, physical education in school, universities is a must. Is there any way that technology can replace this? That means, you know, can we create a virtual university? A virtual, you know, school, virtual colleges. Is there any success factor? Is there success stories available? No. So that means, you know, the technology can be used as a tool or a supportive agent. Look at the need for the education. So probably we know till now that is, you know, there is a formal education system. In the formal education system, probably, you know, the providers are, you know, giving the certificates, probably the degree certificates, you know, the degree or class, whatever. There's a formal education. There also we can use the technology as a supportive agent. But if you're looking at the new entrant, and you say that is, you know, come, open a big university, no, they may not. No, because today they don't mind providing the content, they're providing the various technology aspect, gadgets, everything. But if you wanted to create a university, they may not. Because investment is very huge. On the other hand, let us look at the professional education, job-oriented education. So probably, you know, they provide the technology services to create content to the job market and probably give a certificate. Various companies like, you know, Sun Micro, Microsoft, they provide external certifications, which I can show it to the job market and get the job. So on the formal education, it's very difficult. On the professional education, probably need of the hour, probably the technology can support. On the other hand, look at the whether the government agencies, what they're doing. Societal education, that means probably the farmers, probably the skilled laborers, old age. So if I wanted to train them, if they have they're becoming a learners, then whether these new entrants can provide services to them may not be. You know, that's why I feel that, you know, the technology is a supportive, but at the same time, the present, the mammoth enterprising universities, you know, government agencies, what they have done.
If we could start here, please.
Great, thank you very much. I appreciate the discussions. I'm Jim Gordon, I'm a psychiatrist. I'm the founder and director of the Center for Mind-Body Medicine. And we've worked with school systems and ministries of education in a number of countries, including Haiti and Gaza and in the United States. What we do, which is why I'm here at this workshop, is we teach school counselors, high school teachers, the basic fundamentals of self-awareness and self-care, relaxation, meditation, movement, dance, yoga, self-expression and words and drawings, and then they work with the children. I'd like to, and what we've found is we're working on a population-wide level in Gaza, for example, and we'll be working with 250,000 children. And what we've found is that, first of all, teachers are enormously stressed, including in the United States. And if we're going to help them diversify, we've got to help them integrate first. We've got to help them deal with their own stress, their own trauma, and then help teach them the fundamentals of self-care so they can integrate that into their work with kids. So it's a plea to you for that approach, an invitation, if you're interested in working with me and our organization, the Center for Mind-Body Medicine, and also a question about how you see that working in the various countries from which you come.
Thank you. My name is Daniel Williamson, and I'm actually from Rice University. So I'm wondering if maybe we need to change the name of this session to Enabling New Entrants to Diversify Providers. Because the reason I say this is that sometimes it can be very, very difficult for new players to get their foot in the door with governments. Specifically. For instance, we heard this morning that in Chad, they're still having a lot of difficulty getting access for textbooks for all their students. But given the example of Siavula, which I think the South African government actually printed 2.4 million of their textbooks for grades 10 through 12, how could we use that model to scale these solutions? So my question is, how can we encourage and foster these new entrants to the market, and how can we encourage them to succeed? And also, what does collaboration look like between these new entrants and the old guard, such as Pearson? Thank you.
Hi, I'm Mike Brown from Siemens. There are good teachers. A lot are here today. So it's a typical bell curve. You've got good teachers, teachers who turn up to get a salary, and then teachers who should be taken out and shot. So you've got a good bell curve of teachers. The problem that we have in providing technology, because we want kids to become engineers, and you need to get to kids at 12 years old because that's when they start forming ideas of who they want to be, the teacher gets in the way. The good teacher, no, they understand that their kids will absorb technology at a logarithmic, like you mentioned, you know, get the teacher out of the way, the kids will become far more proficient in technology than the teacher can ever can. Because when a teacher goes home, he's got to mow the lawn, paint the fence, whatever. So the question is how do we enable teachers to feel confident to get out of the way and let the kids get on with the technology, and the teacher can then do the education of how to use that technology? Because at the moment, the teachers who are scared of the technology are locking it out of the classroom.
So a good set of questions. Perhaps we'll go, Tamara, there was a question about how we can enable new entrants and perhaps can work with established players as well.
Yeah. I mean, we at Pearson look to not only work with big established players and colleagues, you know, across NGOs, governments, frenemies like technology companies, but we also are constantly and consistently on the search for new entrants and how do we foster those, how do we work with those. Sometimes we find them, sometimes they come to us. What we're looking at is how can we create a platform to make that more purposeful, much like PNG's Connect and Develop, which really gives you a forum to interact and connect with people who can add to that breakthrough, you know, innovation, et cetera. And if you have any ideas, I'd certainly love to hear them. Can I just say one word about the teacher thing? Because I feel really passionate about it. I think what we've got here today is we've got digital immigrants teaching digital natives. And the biggest thing they need to get past, and I think you mentioned fear, is fear that either technology replaces them. To Sabriya's point, it can't, it won't. And then training on how they can utilize technology to enable a better outcome. There's probably a bit of get out of the way, but I think if we can demystify and train, we can go a long way versus just ask them to get out of the way, because technology is a great enabler in the entire process. It's just we're in that gap where the natives haven't moved through to the teaching staff yet, and we've got to enable the current teachers in that classroom.
Madam Minister, I saw you nodding your head. I wasn't sure if you were shaking it up and down or left and right.
I really agree. I think what I've noted happens is when we bring technology into schools, we're often thinking of the learners and not the teachers at all. And I think we need to turn that around a bit, because a resistance does develop, because you're essentially saying, I'm going to displace you. You're actually irrelevant. I'm more interested in the learners. And I have no interest in you. And of course, I will resist in such a situation. Few companies that I have worked with have actually begun with the teacher. Most are thinking of the young people. And I think we need to turn that around a little bit. I absolutely agree. I think South Africa would love to work with an organization like yours. I recall in 2005, the Human Sciences Research Council published a study on teachers. And actually, it was shocking what the study revealed, that quite a lot of them suffered from hypertension, had a lot of difficulties related to stress, and that very, very inadequate attention was being paid to their health. And so we initiated a program along with the teacher unions, where we work together to try and address this. But I know we just really have touched the surface. So it is an area that needs a great deal of attention.
Great. Dr. Subraya.
Yeah, with respect to the enabling teachers, you know, I agree with you that it's a mindset. So today, the teachers are afraid of the technology. The reason because the collaborative teaching is not happening. Because no two teachers would like to enter into the class and teach the same topic together to a class of people. In bits and pieces, it may be happening, but it is really difficult. On the other hand, probably, we have to motivate the teacher. Look at the Khan Academy. In the Khan Academy, of course, he teaches each and every topics. So probably, we have to show such instances where the teacher can enable themselves. That is the only way. That is, we have to motivate them. Otherwise, it's very, very difficult. See, in my organizations, you know, the first teachers undergo a 3 months rigorous training. The first training is, you know, all the teachers, a new entrant, new teacher, must sit in the class along with the students, and he must learn, he must take the examination, whatever the test, etc. He must excel. So that is a must. So somehow we had to design our own methodology to enable the teacher, especially on the technology. Coming to the another question about the enablement of new entrants, this is a tricky question. That's why I suggested in the beginning itself, there must be a standard body. At the global level, there must be a standard body. So today, what's happening is new entrants are confused. Means, you know, should I open a college? Should I open a university? Should I open an education system? What is that? Or should I provide only the content? Huge content I'll just dump on that. Thousands of textbooks, digital textbooks, I dump on that. The learners are confused totally. Institutions are confused. They don't know what to do. So that's why entrants, they themselves are in an uncertain environment. They don't know what to do. So if you're asking them about the 5 years, what is their vision? 10 years, what is their vision? They don't know. They are looking at the short term. That is why at the global level, probably we should have a standard body. So today I will tell you that is, you know, probably the Abbott in US, most of the universities are accredited. The same university can't afford a degree in some other country, though it is certified in US. The reason because the local controlling body is entirely different. So is there any global standard? So if you design a global standard, so then probably it helps the new entrants to go about that. That's the perspective.
My name is Mudiei Segese. I am a world best innovative teacher of Microsoft 2009. I'm a teacher in Lesotho. I'm really interested in this discussion of use of technology in class. I think the emphasis should be made on you saying technology being used as a tool to enhance learning, not as something that is going to replace teachers. Because that's what I have seen in my country. The way technology is being described is like as if technology is there to replace teachers, to make learners to learn on their own. Whereas the purpose of having technology in class is to help teachers, to ease work on teachers, to make learning easy. And I still think that even teachers of 18th century, 17th century, when books were introduced to schools, they thought that books were there to replace them. But up until today, they have seen that books are not there to replace them, but they are there to help them to make teaching more effective. And the same thing is applying with technology. Technology is here to enhance teaching, and we cannot ignore the world is moving very fast. And as teachers, we shouldn't be left behind because we don't want one day to sit and be taught by learners. Thank you.
Thank you. And that's certainly been our experience at the World Bank. If you could pass the microphone to the gentleman next to you, that it, while rhetoric may be to the contrary, in no case have we seen where the introduction of technology has made have made teachers less central. In fact, we've seen their role becomes more critical and more fundamental. Yes, sir.
Thank you. I'm Andrew Lehman from the Durban Chamber of Commerce and Industry. And I did have a 30-year career as a teacher. That's my fundamental interest in education. I don't think it's a bad thing for teachers to learn from learners. And I think that that probably points to the fact that there must be a very critical examination of the role of the teacher in the modern world, because teachers can't know everything anymore. And the sort of model of the teacher being five steps ahead of the class must in fact be discarded, it seems to me, because in certain instances, learners may well know more, and teachers have to accept that, because that's the way of the world. So I think that when it comes to the use of technology, for example, teachers must understand the role of the technology, but be happy to accept sometimes that their learners know more than they do. And so be it. Because you, as long as you can understand that, you can manage it. It occurs to me that the manufacturers of all these electronic gadgets these days don't produce manuals anymore, because you're expected to find out for yourself. And that learning process, I think, is something that has validity in the context of the school as well.
Thank you.
My name is Rifat Sabah. I'm from the Arab Campaign for Education for All, as well as I'm the director of the Teacher Creativity Center in Palestine.
So this is just a comment I'd like to make, it's not a question as such. I'd like to talk about technology. There is a problem, especially in the Arab world. This problem might be only in our world. It's about the teaching job, the teacher's job. You know, in the past, the teacher was highly considered. And the teacher played a very important role in social transformation. The teacher was in apparently in contact with the population. But today, being a teacher is considered as being a small job, no, not as important, and it's not as valued as it used to be, and it's not as valued as, you know, you were an engineer or an IT specialist. And in the past, the teacher would go around the village, would go and meet with the parents, with the people, and if technology is not used properly, it could actually make those problems even worse. So we need to be objective when we invest in technologies. Sometimes technologies make things more complicated.
Anna Marie Vilamovska, I'm the Secretary of Education and Science of Bulgaria. I had one question, as a matter of fact. So, and it goes just mirroring on the topic and everything that's happening, my own summation, and I'm sorry if it's going to be a bother, but okay, so we're talking about technology, and we're talking about providers, and we're talking about new entrants. But fundamentally, the question is, why education? What purpose should education serve? And yesterday, there was a very nice workshop, and the question over there was, what should the teacher do? Well, it should teach us to have a dialogue with one another. And all of these questions about how technology interacts or replaces, or whether the teacher learns from the students, I think we really need to go back to what the competencies of education are. So what are the key building blocks that an education process should integrate in itself? Can they be provided by a single system, which would be the public system, presumably, or if not, then by whom?
First, I'd like to bring it back here. Matt, I know last time I cut you off, if you would like to respond to any of the comments or questions. Teachers, we seem to be returning to the topic of teachers and teaching.
Yeah, so, well, thanks to all the folks here who contributed very interesting comments. Well, especially that comment about students teaching teachers and teachers having to be comfortable with that. So that was actually what I did when I was a professor, you know. So at the start of the semester, I made it very clear to my students, these are my grading rubrics, and I give you an A+ automatically if you give me a term paper that teaches me something about this topic that I'm teaching you that I don't already know. Okay, so that's my grading criteria. And that actually works because it pushes students to really learn the stuff better and to teach me something that I don't already know. And they have to find out through original research something that isn't covered in class, but is still connected with the class material. So I think what's more shocking to me, I think, you know, when we talk about technology and teachers is that, well, we seem to be reinventing the wheel pretty often. And what I mean by that is that, well, there's been a research base in educational technology for a few decades now, and we don't seem to be trying to draw on that body of evidence and research, and so as a result of that, we seem to reinvent the wheel a lot. And what I mean by that is that if we look historically, so we know from historical precedents that it's just way more difficult to actually integrate technology into schools. In contrast, if you are trying to do an educational technology project, and instead of doing that in a formal schooling environment and you do it in a non-formal learning environment, it's way easier to get it adopted. It's not just the teachers being part of the problem. I mean, I don't see them as being part of the problem. I can elaborate more on that. But it's more about the fact that a whole array of institutional configuration is set up against technology in the sense that if you look at how educational structures, including schools, are currently set up, I mean, it is set up with certain priorities in mind. And when we try to introduce technologies to try to break some of that, for example, you know, trying to get students to move away from rote learning into more passive, active learning, for example, it just gets so difficult because all this stuff is in place to perpetuate the existing status quo. Yeah, so it's way easier to actually get technologies adopted in non-formal learning environments where, you know, you don't have a teacher there who feels so pressured into trying to finish the syllabus or to try to make sure that kids are ready for standardized tests at the end of the year or 4 years later, because standardized tests is one of those things that keep competing against innovative users of technology. That's something that we have found in our own pilots and also in other people's research.
Madam Minister.
I don't think technology is an answer to everything. And I think we should be very careful about creating such an impression. I think it may be part of a set of responses, but I believe your new entrants may be a whole diverse set of people who need a diversified set of provision and providers. So for example, we had to begin a literacy program in South Africa, and it was one that we knew couldn't be offered through one medium, and that you may very well use written material. We had to diversify the providers. We had youth as volunteers. We had teachers who were qualified teachers as supervisors. We used church halls, community halls, stadia, underground garages for street children. So we tried to reach everybody. And technology was but a small part of what we use. So I don't think it's always an answer. And I think we're wrong to create the impression that it is. I also think if we say that it is the answer, we're ignoring what education means. It's far broader than access to a program. It's a whole range of skills that you must learn. You have to be discursive. You have to have access to a broad range of intellectual material. And if you think you'll get it all via technology without an interlocutor of some kind who's more experienced, has greater conceptual capacity than you do, then I think we've misunderstood education. So clearly, for me, technology is not the entire response. Finally, I would agree with a colleague from Palestine that a great deal of work needs to be done to improve the status of teachers in the world. The best performing country in all international tests, both in literacy as well as numeracy and science, Finland values teachers highly and depends really on teachers as the primary instrument or tool in ensuring that their system and their learners perform well. So valuing teachers and according them appropriate status and support is, I think, imperative.
Dr. Subraya?
Yeah, I agree. One point about the role of teacher, as I told you in the beginning itself, a teacher must be a transformational agent. He should probably provide everything as a mentor, as a guide, as a philosopher. You know, it depends upon at what level and who are his students. But when it comes to the new entrant, there must be a standard body who should monitor, you know, the quality of education if the new entrant is concentrating on probably in the education space. So recently, Gartner report suggested that, so today's economy demands not a specialist, but probably a different person. So probably in one area, people are producing generalists who knows the breadth-wise. On the other side, you know, there are institutions who produce a specialist. So when you are looking at the generalist versus specialist, to whom you're voting. So probably in the corporate world or today's economy doesn't require both, but today's world required in between the versatility. So this is the point that is, you know, in the education space, we should strive hard. Not only that, so when you are looking at the new entrant, always people are talking about the content. So huge content is available worldwide. But the question is again, you know, how do you customize the content to the local needs? So that is the need of the hour. So whoever the new entrants, and if they're all at all using the technology, and they have to strive forward, you know, how to come out with a content with a global standard, but customizable to their local needs. And finally, new entrants should not venture into creating a university or creating an educational institute. There is no way. On the other hand, by using the technology, I mean, because the teacher touch, it's very difficult to simulate at any cost. The new entrants should use only the technology as an assistant, as a tool, but not the replacement for the education system.
I completely agree that technology is a tool and the teachers, and what I observed in the US, frankly, isn't far from what you're seeing in teachers. When I grew up, I went to the public school I walked three blocks to, and the teachers made such a difference in my education. and I went on to be a chemical engineer. And slowly, as I was graduating high school, people were looking only at the salaries, what were out there, and they were choosing careers not what based on what they had a passion for, but based on what was the highest salary. And teachers' salaries had slid. They were no longer the center of the community and the respected pillar of that community. And that's where I get back to looking at disruptors in this area, because we've got to get that back. I still believe teacher is such a critical role in the education process, that all these others are great enablers and they can certainly do a lot, but the teacher is such a critical role. And things like Teach for America or Teacher First in the UK, where they're incentivizing the best and the brightest, just come teach for a year and, you know, paying their education or whatever, incentivizing them to come across. And what they're finding is when some of these best and brightest get into teaching, they're staying. They're staying. And unless we start a movement like that and we start bringing people back and we're developing and training and attracting the best back in, all of throwing technology at stuff is never the answer.
C'est Madame Bousso de Sénégal.
I'm Bousso from Senegal. I'm inspector of secondary education. I was 23 years in education, out of which 10 years I tried to integrate the ICTs. And when we talk of the new entrants, we think of the ICTs. But I'd like to, as a teacher, the practical difficulties that we encounter in Senegal, and in particular in Western Africa, when we wanted to integrate the ICTs. The problem is that we have a lot of computers in Senegal and other countries of Western Africa through international cooperation. But the problem that arises is the conditions of accompanying students. If we wish to have a projection, then you need as many classes as projections. And since we are here talking about collaboration for change, we have to raise this question. At this level of different states, we have to equip the schools, high schools, in rooms where you expose the students to the technology. We don't, for example, if you don't have a room, we tell the student, try and make projections at home or simulations using the internet, and we realized that there was a discrimination because the children who had the means of doing so at home were at the top level, and the others coming from poorer countries had find it very difficult to actually follow the progression. And now, today, we want to collaborate and try and solve this problem in Western Africa. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, madam. I will give each of you the opportunity to make one final statement, one final message, one final provocation or challenge to the audience. Dr. Subraya, to you first.
I expect that if any new entrant enters into education space, he must provide, quote, a conducive learning environment to the learners, unquote. Means, you know, he must evolve, design a blended model of the existing conventional model, or integrating the existing conventional model and whatever the emerging technology provides. So by then, probably, he can create a very good conducive learning environment for the learners. So that is what need of the hour.
Thank you. Tomorrow.
Collaboration, collaboration, collaboration. I think if we don't break down some of these walls and join up for open innovation and working together with NGOs, private sector, and government ministries to create the next disruption in education to move us forward, and embracing disruption, but only focused on learner outcomes together. Together, if we collaborate, we'll get there faster and with better outcomes.
Thank you. Professor Camp, very briefly.
Okay, so Well, I like the points that Subraya made about the fact that we are actually not just designing technology as a tool, but also, you know, it's really about designing the learning environment as opposed to the technology. And I'll just add that one way that I think about designing technology is that it's really not about technology as a product, whether it is a hardware, software, or content, but that it is more of a service than a product. And how do you design the service in terms of teacher training, and other kinds of important educational services around the product.
Thank you. And Madam Minister, I will give you the last word.
Thank you. I agree, collaboration, I think, is absolutely vital. The theme of the conference, collaborating for change. And I'd say to the colleague from Senegal that I believe every difficulty is an opportunity. And so let's create internet cafes, let's have young people enjoying that opportunity of the kind of access you speak of. I think if we turn problems around into opportunities, we may find there are solutions.
I think that's a great message to end on. I'd like you to please join me in thanking yourselves, our participants online via Twitter, and our four panelists.